So welcome everyone to our second webinar, Digging In with TPS-MTSU. This is a monthly series that we launched recently, connected to our monthly newsletter, looking at a different topic each month, giving us a chance really to connect with you all, but actually sharing some of the information and details that we're learning as we are actually researching and putting together each month's newsletter. So a couple of things as we get started. One, please be sure to keep your mics muted throughout the presentation. We are going to have a couple different ways for you guys to interact with us, but we would appreciate it if you would keep your mics muted. Also on the screens, if you would, please rename yourself. That way, with your first and last name, and that'll just help us as we go through and are responding to stuff in the chat, as well as just kind of helping everyone to identify each other. So again, we do want to make this as interactive as possible. And the three main ways that we're going to be interacting with you guys throughout this 1 hour session is through first chat. You will see towards the bottom of your screen, you should have a way that you can open up the chat box. Please be aware that that's there, and please feel free to use it throughout the presentation. We will be responding to that throughout, and we'll be able to answer questions and of course respond to that as we're going through the presentations. Also, the reaction buttons. You should also see that at the bottom of your Zoom screen. You have two options with the reactions buttons, hands clapping and thumbs up. And we will be asking you guys to use those in response to some questions again throughout the presentation. And lastly, polls. We are going to have at least two polls during the course of this to give you guys a chance to kind of answer a couple questions and give us a sense of kind of where you guys are at with some of the material that we're covering. Now, with all of the information that we are sharing in today's session, we have it all available in one place, and we are using a Padlet to do that. You'll see that we do have a QR code here that will allow you to kind of go directly to that page. We also have the web link here as well. And each month, we will be guiding to this same page, and so you'll find our monthly newsletter link, links to any PowerPoints that we're using, or any special documents, resources that we have shared throughout the course of these presentations. And then we'll also have a link to our post webinar survey, which we'll talk about towards the end here. So with that, I am going to stop sharing and turn it over to my colleague, Stacey Graham, who is going to talk to us about our overview for the month.
Okay, thank you. Hello, everyone. I am going to just do a very brief overview of our theme for this month's issue. I'm going to share my screen and go to the newsletter. All right, hope you can see that. During the summer months, when we know that you aren't like active in the classroom with students, we like to pick topics that are a bit more fun or a bit less curricularly oriented, and something that has to do with maybe entertainment and leisure. So we chose another music issue, this one specifically looking at Tennessee music. We have done, of course, a lot of previous lesson ideas and lesson plans that deal with music before now, but this was something that we really felt like can always be revisited because everybody likes music. In fact, as noted in the little blurb on the front page, Tennessee as a state is particularly associated with musical heritage, and you can tell that because it was chosen by the U.S. Mint to be symbolized on the Tennessee State Quarter, which I don't know if any of you were in the state quarter collecting craze of a decade or so ago, but we have three instruments on our state quarter. We have a guitar, which pretty much represents kind of country music and kind of the Middle Tennessee traditions. A trumpet, which has to do with that kind of Delta blues and jazz from West Tennessee, and then a violin, or more properly called a fiddle, for your East Tennessee and Appalachian folk music traditions. So this is something that Tennessee music history is important to the United States as a whole, not just ourselves. So we chose three specific people to kind of orient our lesson ideas around for this issue. Bessie Smith, on the west side of the state. From the east side of the state, Dolly Parton. Of course, we've done Dolly before, but there's always, you can never do enough Dolly, right? And then some rock and roll influences, which we will talk more about very, very soon, because Layla is going to be highlighting that particular lesson idea for us momentarily. On page four, we wanted to kind of tip our hat to four different music festivals that have been either postponed or canceled this year due to COVID-19. And of course, Tennessee's music is not just important to our culture, but to our economy. And so these music festivals are one way that translates music into economic benefit. So we're just giving a shout out to Fanfare, Uncle Dave Making Days, the Riverbend Music Festival, and then Bonnaroo. But so not only is music fun to do and a really great way to engage your students in a different format of primary source, but they are, of course, mentioned specifically in the standards for both Tennessee history and, you know, U.S. history in general. So there's even a standard in first grade where you start talking to students about Tennessee music and how important it is to the identity of our state and our citizens. Fifth grade in both the U.S. history portion and the Tennessee history portion, there are at least three different standards that specifically talk about Tennessee music. African-American history talks about music in one of its 1930s and 40s standards. Tennessee history from the high school curriculum, there are about five different standards that specifically talk about music. And then at least a couple in the U.S. history and geography standards too. And some of those high school standards and fifth grade standards are going to be mentioned more specifically when Layla talks about her lesson idea a little bit later. So these are fun, and they're already something that are part of, that's just the social studies standards. You can bring in a lot of other kind of subject areas and make it multidisciplinary too, beyond just the social studies classroom when you're talking about Tennessee music. So without further ado, I am going to turn it over to Layla to give us a bit more of an in-depth look at one of our lesson ideas, and put on your listening ears because this can be fun, y'all.
Hi guys, can you hear or see me? Thumbs up if you can with your reaction buttons. Cool.
Yep, we can see you.
Awesome, okay, great. So I'm gonna go ahead and share this. All right, awesome. If you can see my PowerPoint, thumbs up, we're good. Awesome. All right, guys, so my name's Layla Smallwood. Today we're gonna be talking about musical genres and listening to a few songs together. So before we get started, I do wanna do a little poll. So the poll is gonna ask you, for our people who are watching this recording after the fact, which genre or genres do you think influenced Elvis Presley and rock and roll music? And your choices are gospel, rhythm and blues, soul, rockabilly, jazz, and country. All right, guys, just a few more seconds and then we'll close the voting. Awesome. Okay, so it looks like we're pretty across the board, right? We have high percentages for gospel and rhythm and blues, and then we have some votes for the other genre categories as well. So kind of across the board. Awesome. So I just wanted to get you guys in the right mindset for that. So that was kind of a trick question. All of the genres listed actually influenced Elvis Presley and the evolution of rock and roll music. Today we're going to be talking specifically about how rhythm and blues music and rockabilly music influenced rock and roll music. So before we get started, let's drop Elvis into history and provide you all with a little bit of context. Elvis Presley was born in Tupelo, Mississippi in 1935 and moved to Memphis, Tennessee as a child. Growing up in Memphis, Elvis was surrounded by African-American music and culture. Memphis, Tennessee was the hub center for music in the post-war era. Stax Records and Sun Studios were constantly producing new music and featuring new black and white artists. One of the songs we're going to listen to today was actually first recorded by a black female artist, but it only became super popular with white audiences after it was recorded by a white male artist. So I have the social studies standards just displayed here again for us. Our social studies standards that are connected to today's lessons, our lesson are for fifth grade social studies and high school Tennessee and United States history courses. As you can see, the standards speak to different musical genres, including rock and roll, and mention artists like Elvis Presley. The standards also point to the importance of Memphis, Tennessee in the evolution of music genres. So like I said earlier, today we are going to listen to a few song selections from different genres. We're gonna start with a rhythm and blues selection. So I'm gonna display a few questions as we listen to the four different songs. And as we listen, I want you to consider the questions that I'm going to display on the next slide and analyze the influences of rhythm and blues and rockabilly music on the emergence of rock and roll music. All right, so the term rhythm and blues, often called R&B, originated in the 1940s when it replaced the term race music as a general marketing term for all African-American music, though this term usually only referred to secular, not religious music. The term first appeared in commercial recording in 1948 when RCA Victor Records began using blues and rhythm music as a descriptor for African-American secular songs. The migration of Black Americans to urban centers in the Northeast and Midwest during the early 20th century helped to bring various regional styles of African-American music together to influence one another. The migration also created new markets for these styles of music. Early on, the term rhythm and blues was actually used for the genres or styles of boogie-woogie, African-American swing, jazz, and blues music. All of these styles influenced the development of what is called rhythm and blues today. So again, as we listen to the four songs, I just want you guys to consider these questions. As you're listening, feel free to type an answer to these questions in the chat box. Type a comment in the chat box. My colleagues, Dr. Graham and Ms. Duke, will kind of relay that information to me after we turn off the music. Your thumbs up. Have you heard this song before?
I think there are a lot of people who have heard the other version.
Okay.
More so than this particular version.
Okay, cool. Yeah, that was what I was kind of expecting. In the chat box, if you haven't already, what do you notice about the music, about the beat?
Someone described it as frisky and also as catchy, fast, jiggy. That sounds like something your students would say. Bluesy, maybe a bit slower than the other version. Better than Elvis. The guitar sound really comes out.
Yeah. So what emotions might this song produce when sung or played? How did it make you feel? Just type that in the chat box if you haven't already.
It definitely got a lot of us swaying, whether we meant to or not, whether we realized we were being watched. Got a humorous feel. People tend to like it. It's got depth to it.
Yeah, awesome. Does anybody want to take a guess at who this artist is before we go to the next slide in the chat box?
James already nailed it when it first came on.
Oh, we have an overachiever in the group.
Yeah, there's a ringer out there.
Yes, good. So this song is titled Hound Dog, and it was recorded by Willie Mae Big Mama Thornton in 1952, and it's in the rhythm and blues genre. So I want you guys to think about this year, 1952. We are in the post-war era, and it's a time of prosperity for most white Americans. But for Black Americans, they're living in oppression and facing the systemic racism of Jim Crow. Our next song we'll listen to was recorded in 1956. So let's take a minute here to, in the chat box, to discuss events that happened in the United States during that time period, like 1952 to 1956. Let's provide some more context. So if you have any thoughts or comments on what happened during that time period, put that in the chat box for us.
Well, we don't have any comments yet, but, okay. Oh, integration of military. This is when the Korean War is going on. Of course, it's right after World War II, so we've got that kind of Cold War period, Brown versus Board of Education. And we are almost to the point where we're fighting school desegregation battles. And this is during the Eisenhower presidency, which is good to note, the start of the Interstate Highway Program. And of course, very, you know, early kind of high profile civil rights movement events. And then of course, mass consumer culture with like fast food and McDonald's, youth culture, popular culture being produced. Death of James Dean. That's something I didn't think about, but yeah, that totally falls within this context.
Awesome. So a lot of great answers there. And you guys really hit the nail on the head there. There are so many changes happening in the United States with our culture, with the military, with integration, civil rights movement. Good. So I just wanted to make the connections and influences specifically of the civil rights movement on music and music on the civil rights movement, because I think they both go hand in hand. They're intertwined. Good. All right, guys. So our next song, is going to fall into the rockabilly genre. So have you ever heard of the term rockabilly? If you have, just give me a thumbs up. Cool.
I would say most of us have, yep.
Awesome, okay. So when you think of the word rockabilly or the genre rockabilly, what pops in your head? Can you just type that in the chat box really quickly for me?
Carl Perkins, yep. That was my first thought too. Swing dancing, poodle skirts, a mixture of hillbilly and rock. Of course, the hillbilly is one of the, you know, that's where the word comes from.
Yeah, good. So a lot of good answers. Yeah, so rockabilly music arose after World War II, and it's one of the earliest styles of rock and roll. Mixtures of country music with swing and boogie-woogie styles preceded it in the 1940s. As early as the 1930s, we see Western swing artists freely mixing black and white styles of music. In the 1940s, the honky-tonk style of country music emerged as artists brought a frank and adult sensibility to their lyrics and delivered them with over-amplified accompaniment, including drums and electric guitar, showing the influence of Western swing, as well as the influences of boogie-woogie and blues music. Good. So as we listen to this song, I just want you guys to consider these questions again. Have you heard this song before? What do you notice about it? How does it make you feel? And also kind of consider the similarities and differences between this song and the first song that we listened to. Thumbs up reactions again. Have you heard this song before?
Not getting a lot of thumbs ups here.
Okay. Well, I really hadn't heard it until I started this lesson activity, so I get that. All right, so what do you notice about the beat, the music? Type that in the chat box if you haven't already.
Well, we have been getting comments on musical observations already, very upbeat. The piano is very driving, as well as the trumpet. And then of course that, you know, slap that bass, you know, you can really hear that, and everything's very kind of loud driving and pounding, very fast beat, honky tonk style. So yeah, we've been getting a lot of those, kind of like I like the comment about the growling of the voice and the trumpet.
Yeah. Awesome. And what emotions might this song produce when sung or played? How does it make you feel when you're listening to it?
Makes us feel like we're in a roadside juke joint. Oh, frenetic. Very good. Does make you want to dance. Makes you want to tap your feet, slap your knees. I think I was shimmying my shoulders. Definitely hard to be still. Oh, goes with barbecue.
Okay, so it makes you want to dance, right? Eat a little barbecue. Good.
Oh, and it's harder to understand the lyrics, which is something that we had already talked about previously. So yeah, glad you all noticed that too.
Yeah, it's really hard to pick up the lyrics. Even when you're listening to it right next to the computer, it's hard to put those lyrics together. So I'm glad you guys picked that up. Does anybody have a guess at who the artist is that was singing the song? Before I spill the beans.
We did have a few guesses. Dorsey Burnett, Rufus Bierkes Thomas. A couple people guessed maybe Carl Perkins or Jerry Lee Lewis.
Okay.
But we'll find out.
All right, guys. So this is called We Want a Boogie, and it's by Sonny Burgess. And it was recorded in 1956. And it's going to fall into that rockabilly genre. So we see a lot of people throwing out those names. But this is Sonny Burgess. And this picture is interesting because I thought when I did this PowerPoint, I was like, Sonny Burgess has to be this guy right here in the white jacket, the center of the picture. He's actually the guy in the dark jacket in the back. There. All right, cool. So the next song and artist we're going to listen to might be a little bit more familiar for most people if you haven't recognized the first two. It's going to fall into the rock and roll genre. So the term rock and roll was applied to several related forms of music broadly popular with youth. So you see that in emerging youth culture starting in the mid-1950s. Some styles were already well established and certain audiences used musical devices with certain audiences or used musical devices that had already been around for some time. But in the mid-1950s, they achieved national popularity and soon became the driving forces in much of popular music. So as we're listening to this song, I want you to hold on to the sounds of the first two songs. And we're going to compare their sounds with the sounds of song three. And consider these questions like you've been doing. Just type your answers or comments into the chat box as we listen.
Well, bless my soul, what's wrong with me? I'm itching like a man on a fuzzy tree. My friends say I'm acting wild as a bug. I'm in love. I'm all shook up. Yeah. Well, my hands are shaky and my knees are weak. I can't seem to stand on my own two feet. Who do you think of when you have such luck? I'm in love. I'm all shook up. Yeah. Well, please don't ask me what's on my mind. I'm a little mixed up and I feel fine. When I'm the girl that I love best, my heart beats so it scares me to death. But she touched my hand upon the chill I got. Her lips are like a volcano that's hot. I'm proud to say that she's my buttercup. I'm in love. I'm all shook up.
All right, guys. So, have you heard this song before? Give me a thumbs up if you have. I hope to see a lot of thumbs up. Awesome. Good. So what do you notice about the music in this song?
There were several interesting comments. One is this sounds a lot more polished and a lot more edited and produced, but also it's a teeny, you know, the smoother sound, although you still have that slapping bass. But I love the comment that it's actually allows you to sway to it rather than to just kind of, you know, push, pull, swing back and forth. So it allows for this new kind of dancing, which Elvis, of course, becomes famous for. Somebody had to remark Elvis the pelvis. So you may not want to have to explain that to your fifth grade students, but you know.
I noticed almost everybody was kind of swaying in their little box as they were listening to that one. It's kind of funny, but he does make you kind of want to move and sway to the music in a different way than before. So what emotions might this song produce when you're listening to it?
It's a good one to be in love to. It's fun, it's flirtatious, it's sultry. Yeah, it might have a little bit to do with Elvis.
Or maybe a lot to do with Elvis. I don't know. Good. So how is this song similar or different to the songs we listened to first? And some of you guys have already kind of mentioned some of the similarities or differences.
Right. And one thing that's very clear is you can actually hear all the lyrics and make out all the sounds that he's saying, even though the lyrics are pure fluff, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. And you can still dance to it. You can dance to all of these songs, right? Just, we said in a different way. One makes you kind of want to sway. One makes you want to kind of jump around, clap your hands, tap your knee, or tap your feet and hit your knee, right? Do you guys think this song is similar, more similar to the first song or to the second song?
So far we have a comment that it comes down nicely in between.
Oh, good. That's exactly what I wanted to hear. Yeah, we see those influences coming together. Good. So somebody said Elvis Pelvis, so I guess you already know who recorded this song. Of course, this is all Shook Up, and it was recorded in 1957 by Elvis Presley. The three songs we've listened to are very similar and all seem to build on one another. We can definitely see and hear the connections and influences of the musical genres of rhythm and blues and rockabilly on Elvis's rock and roll music and the song that we just listened to by Elvis. Good. So the last song we're gonna listen to should also be familiar. Please remember to consider the questions displayed as you listen, and feel free to respond in the chat box or comment as we're listening.
You ain't nothing but a hound dog. You cry all the time. You ain't nothing but a hound dog. You cry all the time. Well, you ain't nothing but a rabbit, and you ain't no friend of mine. Well, I said you was high class, but for this time. Yeah, I said you was high class.
So have you heard this song before?
Yes.
Good. Okay. So a unanimous yes. Good. Awesome. And what do you notice about the music?
All right. There were several comments running through it, so I'm going to try to summarize. Very polished. Somebody pointed out, a couple of people pointed out the instrumental solos and how that's kind of a throwback to jazz influence. Also done at RCA Studios, of course, a very important site in Nashville. The lyrics are, people noticed that the lyrics were different from the first version.
Good.
I'm glad that they noticed that. Very danceable again. The beat is, you finally got that rock and roll beat, not a 1-2-1-2 kind of thing. The variations allow for tricks during dancing, such as lifts and so, wow, that's cool. I didn't know that either. So yeah, you don't really think about, you can say catchy and danceable, but like what kind of dance does a certain beat allow? Parents don't like, apparently.
Yeah, that youth culture, they did not like.
RCA and NYC, sorry.
You're good.
Studio B one was the last recording. Studio A, sorry.
Awesome. So you guys did exactly what I wanted you to in this part. I wanted you to kind of compare this song with the other songs we've listened to, but specifically with Willie Mae Big Mama Thornton's Hound Dog version. And as you said, it's a little bit different. The lyrics are different. You can dance to it, but maybe in a different way. You hear different instruments. Do you guys see any other similarities or differences between this song, this version of Hound Dog, and Willie Mae Big Mama Thornton's version of Hound Dog?
Both have very raw vocals. That where the vocals are almost another, instrument, because the the actual words don't matter as much. Both are very good. Elvis is maybe less gritty. Also, First is more soulful, influenced by Delta blues. Yeah. We've had several references to the Ed Sullivan Show, by the way, because that's what we're thinking about when we're picturing Elvis performing. One is great and the other is a ripoff. Oh.
When we vote at the end, you can tell us what you think.
But awesome. Yeah, but still different, but yeah.
Yeah.
But they would have been played in two different types of clubs, probably for two very different audiences.
That's true. And I mean, you have to think again, the time period, 1952 to 1956, things are happening and times are changing. It's really interesting to see the time kind of shift so quickly in those 4 to 5 years. Good. So you guys have all probably guessed the artist. This is Hound Dog, recorded by Elvis Presley in 1956. Definitely rock and roll. So as we know now, Hound Dog was first actually recorded by the Black female artist Willie Mae Big Mama Thornton. But the song only became super popular with your white audiences after it was recorded by the white male artist Elvis Presley. So we have to again consider this time period as we did earlier. The first version was recorded in 1952. So pre-civil rights, pre-Brown versus Board of Education, pre-the Montgomery bus boycott, pre-the murder of Emmett Till. A lot had happened in those 4 to 5 years. The success of Elvis's version of Hound Dog, though, is an example of how many white artists used traditionally African-American music, style, and songs and profited more than the original Black artists. All right, guys. So when finishing up this lesson with students, ask them to consider, as we've done throughout this entire lesson activity, the similarities and differences in the songs and genre. So rhythm and blues, rockabilly, rock and roll, how they're similar and how they're different. And pointing out the similarities and differences, we can see and hear how genres like rhythm and blues and rockabilly influenced rock and roll music and artists like Elvis Presley. We can even make connections to how the sounds, styles, and genres have influenced our music today with our students. All right, guys, so before we finish up, I want to do one final poll. So tell me how you really feel about the songs. You're going to vote and tell me which song choice was your favorite. So for the people voting or watching this after the fact, we have Willie Mae, Big Mama Thornton's Hound Dog version, Sonny Burgess, We Want a Boogie, Elvis Presley, All Shook Up, and Elvis Presley's Hound Dog version. All right, let's make our final voting choices. Like the Jeopardy music is playing in the background. All right, guys, so we'll end the poll. So which song choice was your favorite? In first place, we have Elvis Presley, All Shook Up. And then we have Willie Mae, Big Mama Thornton's Hound Dog. And then Elvis Presley's Hound Dog. They're just 5% between the two of those. So 25% liked Big Mama Thornton's version. And I mean, 25% liked Willie Mae Big Mama Thornton's version. And 20% liked Elvis's Hound Dog. And then 5% voted for our rockabilly choice, Sonny Burgess's We Want a Boogie. Awesome. So I just wanted to end that on a fun note. All right, guys. So I just wanted to display the social studies standards for this activity again at the end so you can review what we talked about and listen to and see how the activity aligns to our social studies standards. I also wanted to display the standards so you can think about other possible ideas and strategies to teach music and musical genres in Tennessee. Thank you so much for your awesome and active participation. This was great. I'm now going to turn it over to Dr. Graham, and she's going to share some links and other resources for the newsletter topic with you all.
All right. Hello again, everyone. I am going to go back to the screen that shows the newsletter so I can give you a bit more of an in-depth look at some of the useful links that are on there that might help. So hopefully that's what you can see right now. Now, building off of what Layla was just talking about, she used the word genre a lot. And of course, we all know what that means, so we didn't really think about it. But your students might not know what the word genre even means. I don't know if they if they still use that on like Spotify or whatever now. But, you know, with the younger students, of course, you'll have to discuss what that means. You know, it's a category usually used to describe something in music or literature or art. So there's that. And she's talking about the different genres of music in American history and Tennessee history quite a lot. And if you want to go more in depth, come on, Library of Congress website. If you want to go more in depth and actually have students read about the backgrounds of these particular genres more deeply, I'm going to show you where on the Library of Congress you can do that. There's a collection on the Library of Congress called The Library of Congress Celebrates the Songs of America. And it used to be called Songs of America as part of the American Mind, Adventures of the American Mind on American Memory, back before when the library used to have that. So you're looking at the collection page right now, and it has these three tabs, you know, about collection items and then articles and essays. If you go to the articles and essays tab, you have a ton of things that can help explain and contextualize even further the similarities and differences between all these different genres in American history and how they actually fit into what's going on, you know, with the rest of the country at these times. So, for instance, if you look at historical topics, you have these different subsections where it explores songs of immigration and migration, songs of work and industry, songs of social change, war and conflict, and songs of politics and political campaigns. So, just for example, if you go to songs of social change, they will not only give you a nice little essay on the topic, but they will give you a little bit of a playlist so you can hear examples about this. And, you know, Hard Times Come Again No More, that's something that we may have all already be familiar with. And then additional links if your students want to delve more into that or do some research or a project of their own. So this is really kind of how to tell the history of the United States through song. And if you go to musical styles, then you also have subcategories. And this is how you're going to get to all those genres with a discussion of each. So because these are all recorded in order to sell records, they fall into the popular slash commercial category. And so if we go to popular songs of the day, you will see all these different genres that have their own contextual essay and playlists. So jazz, blues, country, western and cowboy songs, bluegrass, rhythm and blues. And I don't remember what the difference between rhythm and blues is, but oh yeah, I do remember anyway. But your students might not know. Okay, ragtime, here's rockabilly, hip hop and rap, minstrel songs, and rock. So like for instance, if you go to rockabilly, this is going to contextualize the growth and the development of this genre. Here we have, of course, Buddy Holly. And then they have, you know, maybe a bibliography at the end, but this just very short kind of informational background pieces that you can assign as kind of, you know, the secondary source for your students to read at certain points in a lesson or for homework, to help kind of anchor these movements within these larger kind of, you know, story of the progression of the 20th century. And how it connects and grows out of, you know, different cultural movements. And so this is just a really great collection. They also have interactive maps, which I'm getting to. Okay, yeah. I've been getting a lot of that today where the Library of Congress is experiencing technical difficulties. In some biographies of specific artists, namely they have more than five, but Woody Guthrie, very important, especially the songs of labor and songs of protest. Alan Lomax wasn't a musician, but he was an extremely important ethnomusicologist who collected songs from across America. And of course, he worked for the Library of Congress. So of course, the Library of Congress has all this stuff. Illustrated sound recordings are actually, since they kind of redid their website, these aren't really available to be listened to and watched, but they're kind of like music videos where they show primary source images and they play a track along to it. But they haven't managed to technically get these available yet, but keep checking back on that. So anyway, that's just a brief rundown of what this first link is. It's very useful in all of these different lesson ideas. The National Jukebox, which many of you might have already become familiar with, this is just chock full of different recordings. Now, these are recordings from mostly the 1920s and the 1930s. These are the ones that you can tell from like the image here that Victor Records, with that iconic image of the dog listening to the gramophone. These are those recordings that are nowadays owned by Sony, but are available to be listened to free in public domain through the Library of Congress. And these are part of the National Audiovisual Conservation Center at the Library of Congress, where they're physically conserving these recordings so that they last, because technology changes formats and you actually have to save formats because they can die off. Yes, even these computer files that we have now will need conservation in the future. Because these are from the 20s and 30s, that of course is a deep into Jim Crow era. So the library does have a disclaimer where it says that some of these recordings are going to be inappropriate for our modern, more politically sensitive age. So you want to pre-listen to a lot of these things. But there are a lot of instrumentals. But this is where you get the kind of famous scratchy sound recordings that your students are automatically going to be like, that's old, that's ancient. But they can really get a lot out of it if they sit down and actually take the time to listen. And that you can talk about the differences in technology as well as the differences in cultural tastes and influences. So that's the National Jukebox. And the last thing that I want to show you are the last two links in this important links box. I'm gonna kind of skip over all of these previous newsletter lesson ideas that we have done, which pretty much speak for themselves. We have a primary source that on music and dance as well. But there are two blogs in particular that delve into musical topics at the Library of Congress. One of them, it's probably going to be not as relevant to you, but it's the NLS Music Notes, that just stands for National Library Service. And this one is more about putting music into formats for people who are hard of hearing or hard of seeing or need assistance, technically speaking. But that often has some really good, look at that, topics within it. But it's this Now See Here blog that is gonna have tons and tons of really great little short blog posts that connect a different musical topic to American history and culture. This one, of course, about John Philip Sousa, the Marching King. And this is the blog of the National Audiovisual Conservation Center, which I just mentioned. And you can search within each of these specific blogs. So for instance, if I want to write Elvis, if I can type Elvis Presley, which of these blogs would mention Elvis Presley? So you can search on any other topic you want to. Now, there are going to be other blogs in the Library of Congress that are going to touch on music as well. Unfortunately, you can't search within all the blogs at once. The only way to do that is to just search on the main library page. And then if something is within a blog, it'll pop up and it'll just show up in your regular search. But you see there's a performing arts blog where you can find a lot of music things. Musical technology will be in Inside Adams. Folklife Today is the blog of the American Folklife Center. So if you want to talk about folk music, you can do a lot of searches within that. And then sometimes they have these things within the blog that's created for teachers. So this is the one that you're most familiar with, Teaching with the Library of Congress. You can search within that too. All right. So that's basically what I wanted to show you, make sure that you were familiar with. And now we're going to take a closer look at our featured feature with Kira. So I'm going to turn it over to Kira right now.
Thank you, Stacy. So yeah, we're going to wrap up today's webinar with a discussion of the TPS Teacher Network. So for those of you who may not be familiar with this, you can find it at tpsteachernetwork.org. This is a social media type platform that the Library of Congress invested in back in 2014. And what they did, we have a nationwide network of TPS programs that are doing different PD, working with different education programs, and they wanted to create an online platform that would allow all of these different educators who are interacting with various TPS programs to have an online community, a place where they could come and they could share some of the stuff that they're doing in the classroom, they could post questions, and continue to learn from each other even after their TPS workshop or course might be over with. And so what you'll find here is that you can create a free account that will allow you then to log in and access that community. So you can see here, this is the page that you would find, and you can, once you hit that login, if you don't already have an account, just click join the network, and that'll bring up the page where you can create that account. Now, I, of course, already have an account, and so once you create an account, what you will find is that there are a number of different groups, and so each of these different groups really kind of focus towards different content, different curricular areas. Some of them are very thematic focused. Some of them are more pedagogy. So you can see a wide variety. There is a general section within the network called the TPS Commons, and everyone who creates an account has access to the TPS Commons. So what you will find there is kind of a general message board. And so you will see that there will be lots of different topics that people are discussing. Right now there are a lot of topics that are going on related to events that we're seeing going on around our country, especially dealing with the protest against police brutality. And so you'll see people have been posting ideas for how to approach that with their students. You'll note that within each group, there are different types of postings that you can do. So some, there will be discussion threads. There are albums, and you can think of this as sort of like a primary source set where people are kind of creating groups of images. People can post videos, they can upload files to the network, can post links, can make announcements. And with any of these, again, you'll have different ways that you can interact with them. So, some of the recent discussions happening in the TPS Commons, as I mentioned, have been dealing with kind of current events. You'll also see in recent months, there've been a lot of discussions about helping each other, as we all transition to kind of figuring out how to teach remotely and how to share information with our students when we aren't able to physically meet with them. And so there's been a lot of discussion of that. You'll find a lot of topics on that as well. So you'll see some postings, some links. Again, there's a lot of information that's within the TPS Commons, but that's kind of the general message board. If you're interested in seeing some of the more specific groups, you can go through and look at the all groups and it'll kind of pull them together. Now there are three different types of groups. There are public groups, which anyone can join. There are private groups, some of which are geared more towards specific events, maybe specific PD events or specific audiences. And then there are some that are hidden groups that, because they're for, again, kind of specific things within the overall TPS program. And so these are all listed chronologically by when those groups were created. So you're going to see the newest groups posted there. One that I want to draw your attention to is this teaching online with primary sources. Again, I know a lot of districts are discussing various ways that they may approach bringing students back and how they're going to teach next school year. Some of them are looking at these hybrid models. Some of them are looking at the possibility if they have to go remote again, what that's going to look like. If you are kind of interested in kind of, you know, looking for some resources, seeing, you know, some different ways people are approaching that, this group on the network is particularly good. Our partners with the TPS program in the Western region and Metropolitan State University of Denver. Their program has always been very heavy on the kind of virtual online learning side, since their region actually covers a huge geographic area. And so they stepped up early on in this, you know, as we were all facing this transition, and did a webinar series, which actually is all available through this group. And you'll see within these recordings that there are a lot of topics that they covered again that may be very beneficial to you as you think about, again, what next school year might look like. And so you can see here some of those that they have done, looking at strategies, looking at some different technology platforms. Some of them are activity focused. But again, you know, these are all available for your viewing and can be a good resource for you. One thing that I wanted to point out that we have recently been doing within the TPS Teacher Network, oftentimes in the past, we have most heavily used this when looking at some of our multi-day events, especially our summer institutes. And so for those of you who may have attended a summer institute in the past, you know, may have, you know, may already have an account or used to seeing kind of how we use this. Well, right now we are, every week, Stacy has been creating a close reading exercise that we're posting on our Facebook page. And we're also creating an album here and posting it in this group. And this is our TPS-MTSU Expanding Citizenship, What is an American group? Now, the close reading exercises here are all PDF files. We've got one that's got an associated video with it that's available on our YouTube channel. But you can download all of these where she has taken excerpts from documents. Again, we're trying to pull things in that are referenced within the curriculum standards. So again, they're going to be things that you're going to need to be covering with your students. But you can pull them out here and this kind of will guide them through a close reading exercise with these. We will continue to be adding to this and to some other things we're going to be putting within this group. So again, if you're interested and want to, you know, look for this kind of online community of teachers who are exploring ways to use primary sources, the TPS Teacher Network is a great resource for you. So with that, we will take questions. Does anyone have any questions? If you do, if you will kind of plug those in to the chat box there, we will cover some questions before we start to wrap up. All right, so if we don't have any questions, so just to remind you guys again, all of the resources and things posted today, you will find on our Padlet. And again, we'll be adding to that each month. And so that is a way to go back and find all associated PowerPoints, links, that kind of thing for each of our webinars. You will find that there. That is also where you will find the link to our survey, post-survey for this event. We do ask that you take a few moments to fill out that short survey. You will see the link here, or again, you can go to our Padlet page and you can just click there and it will take you directly to this page. So that form, again, once you fill that out and we get that, we will be able to generate your participation certificate for today so that you can turn that in for PD credit. I try to get those out within a day or two after we receive your forms, your completed forms. So again, if you will, please take a few moments to fill that out for us. That just helps us to shape these webinars as we go forward, because we do want these to be as helpful as possible each month when we visit with you and kind of share what we're doing in our newsletter. We are also, of course, interested always in your feedback as far as topics and resources that you're looking for going forward into next school year and as you're thinking about what next school year might look like. And also, if you are not, haven't had a chance to see our upcoming list of events, we do have a full list on our website. Stacy, Layla, if one of you guys will drop the workshop link into the chat box real quick. We will be doing a full array of online workshops this month and next month, again, leading up to the start of the next school year. We invite you guys to join us for those. And we'll be recording many of them and posting those on our YouTube channel as well. So again, you'll be able to view those after the fact. Our longer ones, we will not be posting the entirety of those, but the short hour long ones we will be. So again, if you have any questions, please feel free to reach out to us. We thank you guys for taking the time to join us today, and we hope to see you next month. We are going to have a little bit of difference in date and time next month. July is pretty busy for us. So our next webinar will be on July 8th, which is a Wednesday, and we will be doing that at 1 p.m. on July 8th. And our topic for next month is using maps, which Layla is super excited about. So,
I will not be presenting the main lesson.
All right. Well, thank you guys so much for joining us, and we hope to see you next month.